quite sophisticated and extensive. England has also been very good at publishing cases and reports, and its judges have been more than willing to do that. So what you'll find in English law is your standard charter party type clauses and contracts may have been the subject of judicial consideration. Ever wondered what a weather working day is? There's an English case law about it. That's not true in most jurisdictions. It says English courts and judiciary have a long-standing and ongoing reputation for prompt, efficient and fair dispute resolution. I'm not sure I would say it's prompt. No law is prompt. First sign you've walked into a bad lawyer's office, they say, oh, we'll sort all this out very quickly. There's nothing quick about the law, as I'm sure you all know. But it doesn't necessarily matter. Delay is always going to be a bad thing. But it's relative standards of delay. My experience is Swiss courts are often extremely slow, for those who've ever been involved in them. Many countries' courts are very slow, but if you can resolve a case within 2 or 3 years, that's quite good, because most likely it'll settle well before then. Whereas if everybody knows a case will take 10 years to resolve, then it probably won't settle until you get to year 8. People negotiate and settle cases in the shadow of the law. What judges and arbitrators actually say and do at the end of the day usually isn't very important. It's what they might say or do which is important. And in the meantime, you've got people negotiating behind the scenes. That's the way we learn to work. I want to say something about arbitration. Arbitration is basically privatised courts. People talk about arbitration all the time. Most disputes in the commodity sector are resolved through arbitration. Is it a good thing? Well, it's like saying, is private medicine a good thing? I mean, yes, of course, because the fact that it exists means it's meeting a market demand, because people are not happy with the equivalent of public resources. If they were, then there wouldn't be a market in private medicine. So, yes, you're buying a superior product. You're buying your way out of the state system, and you're saying, we're going to have our own private judges, and we're going to pay those judges by the hour, just like we do our lawyers, and we're going to call arbitrators, and they're going to resolve the dispute for us, using the rules we want, hopefully in a more efficient and effective way, confidentially if that's what we want, and along a timescale we want. Now that's the theory. The practice is that arbitration is not always cheaper, but I still think that it is on balance. You know the people who really don't like arbitration, because there have been swings between court litigation and arbitration over the last few decades. The people who are really coming out now not liking English arbitration are English judges. Why do you think that is? It's because they're now complaining that they've got no more case law. Because what you like to do if you're a judge, you like to write decisions that get published and then get read by law students. Right? That's your main motivator. And you want to see the common law develop. And the problem with arbitration is that it's all private, and those decisions aren't written down. And then because jurisdictions have been competing in a race to the bottom to make sure the courts don't interfere with arbitrators' awards, therefore there's no effective appeal, as there are arbitrators. Law being made by arbitrators effectively isn't being made at all, because it's all being hidden away. And that's a debate that's currently going on. Right now, between England, Switzerland, arbitral institutions, arbitration is so private that it's impeding the development of the law. And the argument from a client's point of view is this. I don't want to pay the extra amount of money it costs to create and develop a common law. Okay? I don't want to subsidise that. Okay? All I want is my own dispute resolved quickly and simply as possible. I'm not interested in subsidising the grand system. Whereas judges in England say, no, you've got to subsidise the grand system, because the reason the system ever works in the first place is because money was subsidising it and creating case law and creating judges who were writing decisions, and you've got to keep that going, Mr. Modern Client, just like all your predecessors did over the decades and centuries earlier. So that debate is now going on between, that's the main difference between litigation and arbitration. A person engaging in court litigation is to a certain extent subsidising a system which sees its goals merely resolution of the dispute as high. They may see it as maintaining the judiciary, maintaining the integrity of the legal system, maintaining the case law, whatever it may be. Debates about whether you can enforce court judgments and arbitration awards worldwide are very, very technical, generally are only interesting to lawyers, but suffice it to say, you will find, if you find it difficult to enforce an arbitration award in Russia, you'll find it difficult to enforce a court judgment in Russia as well. That's just life. These are some of the advantages of commercial arbitration set out. An arbitration is easier because you can set the rules. I don't know whether any of you have seen court rules, but virtually every country in the world, they're usually large, fat books. For some reason, most countries in the world, they're either green or white. I don't know why. But they're full of complicated rules because judges have laid rules upon rules. Because look at it like this. If a group of people come together in a voluntary association to write some rules, they're not going to want a lot because they're not going to want to make things complicated. And that's what happens in arbitration. Or the rules of the STSA, I have to read them. Well, I think they're short and easy, right? Because it's essentially a voluntary group of people. Whereas if bureaucracies make rules, they tend to make them much longer. That's the main difference between litigation and arbitration. But these are the sorts of mechanisms that people are using to resolve disputes in England, in Geneva, in the various judicial arbitration centres worldwide, the related disputes right the other side of the world. And this is happening every single day, and this is what I do. Virtually none of the cases I do have anything to do with Switzerland at all, apart from perhaps the accidental location of one of the parties to the in Switzerland. But the cases are not about Switzerland. They're not about Switzerland. They're about ships on voyages on the other side of the world. They're about accidents that have taken place on loading and unloading. But about people having stolen cargoes in the middle of countries thousands of miles away. Some of the bodies used to resolve international disputes, you may have heard of some of these. The International Chamber of Commerce is in Paris. The London Court of International Arbitration is in London. Stockholm is an intriguing venue for dispute resolution. It was the only place in the Soviet period during the Cold War which the Soviet Union would allow Soviet companies to arbitrate disputes with. So it became an arbitration centre as a sort of neutral forum with in disputes between Soviet companies and Western companies. It then had a dip, and now in the current political environment, it is fighting because it is. Has a substantial case load and increase more recently. There are also arbitration institutions in CIS countries themselves. You've got Russia, Ukraine, and Belarusia here. These are generally not used in the context of international transactions. They are not perceived as reliable. They are not perceived as lacking the requisite levels of corruption. The reality is that although there are arbitration institutions in many places in the world, the main centres of arbitration are, and I'm just taking them west to east, London, New York, London, Geneva, Dubai, Singapore, Hong Kong, and Sydney. That is generally, Paris I forgot as well, that is generally where arbitration is done. If you see an arbitration clause pointing you to one of these institutions, you might want to think again whether that's a good idea. Russian law is like many laws, it has a few unusual features. It doesn't allow corporate disputes to be arbitrated. So in theory, if you're working through a vehicle in the Russian Federation, you may find that you're subject to the compulsory jurisdiction of the Russian courts, of the Russian law. There are lots of ways of getting around that. And it won't sound like an unusual problem to you. You will have probably come across rules like this in countries all over the world. It's a way that national legal systems try to maintain a level of control over the internationalisation of legal contracts. Because what people do now is that they will say, you might enter a joint venture for your upstream projects with a company in Russia or a company in any corner of the world, but you'll probably say that the shareholders' agreements might be subject to English law and disputes to be arbitrated in Geneva. So what you're trying to do is to lift all disputes out of the context of the local legal system, and you find rules like this trying to design to stop you. Some of it is just, how can I put this, domestic legal parochialism, thinking what's wrong with our laws. Some of it's more overt attempts at state control over transactions. Some of it's just damn confusing, because law doesn't always develop in rational ways. And in the few cases where people have tried to write down a law from scratch without adding bits on to make everything more and more complicated, Napoleon tried it. The law got added on, made more and more complicated anyway. So that's why you're going to find a lot of very strange legal rules in a lot of jurisdictions. And you have to be alert to them, because you almost certainly don't want to be bound by them, and you've got to find ways of recognition in arbitration is done at the New York Convention 1958. Every CIS country, I think except Turkmenistan, has signed up to this. The idea here is that an arbitration award should be automatically enforceable in virtually anywhere in the world. The reality is never, of course, quite that simple, but let's say that it's much easier to enforce an arbitration award in Switzerland than it is in Azerbaijan, for example. There are some known jurisdictions in the world where it is notorious that it's virtually impossible to enforce arbitration awards. The Gulf is the main problematic part of the world. But these days, problems of enforcement and cross-border pursuits of